So good afternoon, everybody. It's the first time that I participate in this very interesting Allschwil HP meeting. I enjoyed from the beginning to the end all the presentations, and I'm very impressed by what by the work which has been done on all kinds of models of HP and the information we got from the HP people themselves. And so this is a little diversion from the theme of the conference, although there is one tangent point with this machine with existing HP designs, I think. And so this is, I think, a refreshing story on an old architecture which we rediscovered. That means myself and Brent Hilpert from Vancouver in Canada. This all is always done over the internet. I never met Brent. I would like to meet him once, but I've never met him, but we had a very good interaction. And I will tell you what we did. And I think, if you see the discovery of the architecture, which is largely forgotten, it could probably be useful for all of you in later designs. Yeah, okay, thank you. And so the machine I had at home is standing here, in fact. This is what is called Ricard. It's a unique model. I mean, there's only one model of this, which is a machine with Nixies, 12 Nixies. And this was built... Jesus Christ, I don't use this microphone anymore. Finished, done. No, I don't want anymore. And so this machine was built in 1971, 1 year before the HP 35. And this was built in Tokyo by a company which is called, and which made a lot of different models, which is TEAL, which is the Tokyo Electronic Applications Lab. And you see the director of the lab there, which I discovered in a nice film, which I recommend to everybody of you, which is called The Calculator Wars. And this film shows what was going on in Japan, a fierce competition between different companies. And many of them went out of business because they had a lot of old models which they could not store anymore, because the other ones which were, coming on the market, which could do more and which were much more cheap. So this design consists of a lot of diodes and resistors. It's in fact full of resistor diode logic. And there were, in addition, several undocumented Japanese MOS ICs. We didn't know what they were doing. So it was total mystery. Could we repair this machine? And so, in fact, we went on. We said, let's do it. And so just to describe a little bit of the functionality of the machine, it could do the basic functions, addition, multiplication, etc. It had a telememory, which is a kind of a memory which you load with the red and the black equal button. You could subtract and add. You did not see the result, but it was internally adding and subtracting. And then you have a constant function here. You could push this button. Then you load into memory a constant multiplicator or a constant divisor. That was it. Then you can set the number of decimals, digits behind the comma. And that was it. But we had no technical documentation, not at all. There was no clue on the architecture. We didn't know what arithmetic was used, what was the bit size, how many memories, what were the registers, what was the size. Nothing was known. So it was, quite an exploration, and it was a very nice experiment, I think. I would recommend everybody to have once the same experiment. And so what were the symptoms of the machine? You see already something. I have a little film here, which should start here somewhere, I think. Yeah, it's starting. You see, there was a digit very, very bright. Then there were some digits you could put in and do any operation, but it always ended in zero or overflow. So nothing was working. One digit was very bright, etc. What was going on here? And so I started to open it and looked into the power supply and saw dried out capacitors and a burned out, a power transistor to supply the machine. So I took it out, repaired the transistor, replaced all the capacitors, and tried again. And it was already somewhat better, and the better result you have seen in the previous film. Before it was garbled numbers, etc. So that was already solved. So there was progress, but of course I ended up with this mysterious device. You see all the resistors, all the diodes, and a few, totally unknown Mitsubishi and NEC ICs. What to do? So, in the middle of this puzzle, I knew there was a colleague in Vancouver, Brent Hilpert, who had already done a lot of research on old calculators. He is, in fact, a person, as I understand, he was working in the Vancouver computer division of the university, and so he had a lot of experience. He's also extremely well in understanding these schematics. I mean, he's a genius, honestly. And so I contacted him and said, yeah, let's have a look. And so I started to look into the PCBs and send him photographs. You see, these are double-sided PCBs. Eh? Hand-drawn in the old Japanese times, and then mass-made, but on two sides, with all the components here, with some components under the nixies, and which made it difficult to communicate, I mean, in the beginning, the layout of the PCB. Then there were the drivers here for Hitachi, the display drivers, etc. And so there were a lot of, not only ICs, which were unknown, but there were these mysterious red and black blocks. No clue what it was. So, I mean, it was quite a challenge from the very beginning to dare to do it. But, I mean, we never give up, you see. Defeat is not an option, as Churchill said. And so this is then, I mean, how should I mean, honestly, communicate to Brent? How, I mean, how the layout of this thing is, I made pictures, I mean, orthogonal, so that we didn't have any parallax, etc., so that he could easily distinguish the tracks. But, I mean, under the nixies, no way. The only solution which I came up after, I mean, a week or two, we tried several things, but the only solution was, in fact, to hand draw all the little contacts below the nixies like this, you see? It's the only way. And so I drew here the resistors, the diodes in their correct direction, the capacitor, etc. Everything was there with the little holes, which, of course, we could see when we turned the PCB, and then we could match them. So in that way, I communicated to Vancouver the layout of this first PCB and also the second one, which was even more of a challenge, because there were a lot of hidden tracks under the ICs, you see. They went in all kinds of ways. They did a lot of strange turns in between all these kind of unknown blocks. So it took me really a whole afternoon to measure, because I couldn't even see the tracks, to measure and to be sure that I drew the right things. I mean, then under this connector, which is connecting the two boards, and this is an elevated connector, so the board is then sticking in, there were a lot of other tracks, and Brent said to me, I make a photograph, etc. But I thought, I mean, look, this is all inclined, it cannot be, I'll just draw all the things and send it to him. So I worked two afternoons finishing this and trying to control as much as I could, because after a while you get really headaches, that there were no errors. And as I discovered later, Brent found 4 errors. I mean, you can't imagine. And so so finally, then Mr. Hilpert had so much information that he could draw for each of the two PCBs, this double-sided, you don't see very well, but I mean, there are the red tracks which are going on the other side. So he had all the information to start to decode and to reverse engineer this PCB, even not knowing some of the ICs. We didn't care, we just went on. And so the big clue here, and I think also for you all, that the lesson which you could draw is this interesting logic design. I mean, the gates, as you see here, were made out of diodes and resistors. You see, pull up or pull down. And depending on their position, you see these ones are reversed. You get an OR gate in negative logic, or an AND gate in positive logic, and also in negative logic, you see. And so this is the basic idea, and you need to know this. If you don't know this, I mean, you are in shambles. You have no idea what to do with that thing. And it's even knowing it, it's not simple. But I mean, what else was there? So the active devices were PMOS transistors in ICs. I mean, this one, for instance, this inverter here. There were then, in addition, the other, I mean, as we discovered later on, the other ICs were, in fact, sets of inverters in one IC, or ring resistors, etc. So more complex, but most of the gates were really done in this what is called the diode and/or logic. And then, of course, the Japanese optimized so much that, I mean, the cost of the whole device was going as much possible down. And this is not the same as, of course, diode transistor logic. It's even more simple. It's just resistors and diodes. The only point which you have to care in this design is the fan-out. I mean, sometimes the voltages drop so much that you get into trouble in getting some components to switch. But I mean, it was carefully thought out by the Japanese, and I'm really astonished by what they did. I mean, having not the means in that time, as we have now, storage scopes, very limited, etc. The pulses were, I mean, microsecond level, I mean, it all had to fit, correctly overlap. I am very much impressed by what was accomplished by the Japanese colleagues. But even knowing this basic point of having the gates as diodes and transistors and resistors, it's not simple. You have to be very careful and very meticulous. And so this is the first drawing of the design after having reverse engineered all the tracks and not making any error, of course. And then you start to rearrange the things so that you see appearing the gates, you see? Here is an inverter, here is an AND gate with negative logic, here is again an inverter, etc. Here is an OR gate, but you have to really precisely reorient things and check it with a lot of patience to come to a design where you are sure that everything's right. So, see, this is one of these blocks. It was in fact a set of four diodes connected together, so it had five pins, four inputs and one common pin at the end. And so, but even in this block, you see you have to rearrange this one little diode in the right way to recognize that here is an OR gate, you see? I mean, I found it fantastic to be able to participate in all these things and to learn from Mr. Hilpert there. And finally, you get then the logic network and you can then start to understand what's going on. But this, it's impossible. This helps you and this is the final thing. And there you can start to reason on this system. What is going on here really? And so that took, I mean, a few months to get the full schematic, and I can let it pass around, have it with me. It's a 22-page document where you see one page with the registers. There are three registers we discovered. This is this tally register here, this memory, and these two are used for addition, multiplication, and division, subtraction. Here you have a decimal point counter. There's a counter which keeps track where the decimal point is sitting, etc. Then there are state registers. It's in fact, we discovered, it's a state machine. So there are 15 states. So the whole thing is in fact hardwired and is determined by the states in the machine. So if you have a certain state, then it is adding. If it's another state, it's subtracting, etc. So it's all hardwired in a very, I mean, elegant and very clever way. Then you have flags. If you push a button, there's a flag set. A button is pushed, a numerical button or the decimal point button, etc. Then there is here a special page on this addition and subtraction logic, and there are, I mean, in this way, 22 pages, and I'll we'll show it to you later on. So then also, we could, derive from this the pulse structure. This is the basic clock here. There are, in fact, two clock parts, and it's, in fact, a bit similar to the V1 and V2 in HP. Very similar to that. So, and but otherwise, not known in such kind of circuits. So this is the basic clock, and then you is derived from that bit phases, bit 1, bit 2, bit 3, bit 4, etc., repeating, and then digit phases. So one digit consists of 4 bits, and all the signals are there to make coincidences with other signals to pick out a bit or a digit, etc., etc. So there are these 4 bit phases, and then there are the 17 digit phases. And so this, I mean, became then clear. And then after all the analysis, and I will show what we did, we got a full understanding of the machine until the most possible detail. And we discovered, in fact, also not documented things, which was astonishing. And so there are 15 states in the state machine. And there were very unusual voltage levels, minus 24 and 0 volt. I mean, never seen that before. And then there are the loop counters here. There is also a leading zero blanking counter for that. And then there are the three registers with 64 bits. Eh? So four bits per digit. And these are 16 BCD digits. So it's BCD logic, I mean, is used in the machine to do all the operations. And so after that, not only that, we knew the states, but also we know how the interaction between the states is. You see here, state 11 goes to state 22 or something like this, etc. So the whole interaction is here puzzled out with the description here, what happens really. And as I said, there is no instruction set in this machine. It's not like this. It is all hardwired and using this state machine design. I mean, you put a state and then some function, another state, another function, etc., which is... it was impressive for me. I didn't know all this and I learned a lot. And I mean, I hope it can also be instructive for all of you. So then we got to all the ICs here, which were not, I mean, part of them were known because Mr. Hilbert had already done some reverse engineering on other types of Japanese calculators, but a few of them were totally new. And so we had to guess, I mean, to logically derive from the whole set of things there what I would do. And so we had a full adder here, a double full adder. Then we had this kind of Nixie display IC. Then we had a set of another one, which was in fact more performant. There were six inverters instead of five. We didn't know what it was. Then there was this one, this Mitsubishi ring register, etc. This was derived, it must be that, fine. And so, a few months later, after it was derived, I have some Japanese contacts. And so I knew the reference in the Tokyo National Library and sent the reference, said, look, I want this book, and could you make some copies? And so this electronics book is the only one in the West existing, this copy. Nobody has it. I couldn't find it. And so then we checked the ICs, and you see, lo and behold, this was the drawing in the neck book. This was the drawing we had. This was the drawing in the neck book. This was the drawing we found. By deducing. This was this ring register, dual 16-bit shift register. This was the full adder, dual, I mean. So, fully sure that now things were right. I mean, already before, because we continued not having these things, already quite sure that things were right. Then we started to repair. And so, in the first minute of just starting to measure very carefully here, suddenly the whole thing stopped, blank, finished. And I said, my God, what now? I mean, so let's check where it is. And so I found out that this board had a very big short. It was, I mean, 0 ohm. And so how to find, I mean, what's going on in this? Where is the short here? I cannot desolder all the ICs or all the components to find which is the short. The simple solution was, in fact, to apply 2 volt and see what it was then drawing 1 ampere in DC. And then I had a very sensitive infrared camera from the lab, which I put to a sensitivity of 0.1 degree. I put it on, and in a few seconds I saw this bright thing coming up. This was the short. And so it was this IC, this one, this MuPD105C, which, I mean, there is no availability, so I needed a substitute in addition to all the complications I had already. So I was ready to give up, more or less. I said, look, I mean, now it's finished. What can I do? But no, that was not counting on my colleague in Canada. He had already a design with modern ICs to replace it. Wonderful. Really wonderful. But it is not so simple. Because in this design, I mean, the ICs, and this is a drawing of the inverter, you see what a peculiar behavior this is. This was the measuring circuit. This was this inverter, the working one, from another IC which I used. So this is the gate voltage and then the drain voltage here. You see, it switches from 0 to minus 24 at around minus 7 volt. Totally, I mean, I don't know anything which works like this. Also, Mr. Hilbert didn't know anything like this. And so we had to find the substitute with modern ICs, but adapting the voltage levels on the front and on the end. I mean, what an exploration. I mean, I enjoyed it a lot because in the end it all worked, but I mean, it was quite something, a real thriller. And so so the first error we found in the machine was that one of these digit phases was defective. It was not working. And in fact, one of these outputs was not there. There was an internal problem in this IC. And so then Mr. Hilbert designed something. He took the previous one, then had here an SR flip-flop and reconstructed the other one which was missing, and we connected it. So we had already the missing digit phase, which was really important because it's used everywhere in the calculator. And so already a lot of things were solved during this, but still there were problems. So we continued to look into the whole design, and then we found that at least 2 inverters were broken. So the bitstream in the machine was interrupted. Did not go to the place where it wanted, because one of these inverters and 2 of these ICs were broken. So we replaced that then temporarily with a breadboard construction with a transistor, which, I mean, adapted everything to the right voltages and pulse widths, etc. So that was done also, but still not done. No working machine. What's going on? And at some point, we both wanted to give up, but we said, defeat is not an option. We go on. And so we went on. And then we had this burned out MUPI 105C, for which there are two substitutes here, made by Mr. Hilbert, you see. Finally, I choose this one. And in fact, this is a modern ring register, which you can put to any number of shifts, 16, 17, 18. You have a combination of in a kind of digital way. I mean, binary things you can put here. And so we put it to 16 here. Then we put a diode isolations here, not to have, I mean, the strange voltages coming in, but nevertheless the pulses coming in, and also adapted the output from the minus 15 volt, which was used here, to minus 24 using this adaptation transistors here. So that was put in, and lo and behold, the whole thing worked. So we had an unknown IC, we derived from this the function, and we built a working copy with modern ICs, and it worked. I mean, I was quite happy to see that, yeah. And so, in fact, you see here the machine during the repairs. Eh? This was this kind of substitute which was put in for the digit phase. Still, there was something going on, but I had already numbers, no zeros anymore. That was promising, etc., etc. So it went on for 6 months, really. I mean, eh? Not all the days, but I mean, every second weekend, a few hours working on this machine to refresh the mind from the other type of work I'm doing, which is also quite interesting, but sometimes you have to change your mind. And so then after, I mean, so we started really to repair and to debug and to reverse engineer in February. And this was the status in end of May. So it was then in fact 3 months we did. And so you see, this is the substitute I built for the broken output in the ring register, for the digit phase. This was a substitute, and it is in fact here the substitute, because there's another story on this. This is a substitute, I can let it go around. You see how I did it. It just fits inside the machine. And the substitute for the broken MUPI 105C. There was in fact another problem, which was a broken tract or a bad contact, I don't know. Because we supposed something must be going on here with the tense carry. And we were looking, I was looking and measuring, etc. And then at some point I had to solder a little connector to measure. And when I soldered it, the whole thing worked. So there must have been there a cracked soldering thing or a bad feed or some. It's done, it was gone. And so then the whole thing worked. And so I was quite happy. And I will show you here a demonstration of one of the first tests I did. And you see how nice these machines are working. And also the speed. But I have to get my arrow here. Where is the arrow? I don't find the arrow now, this is gone. This is always the problem, I have to put it to, there it is, okay, fine. So let's now see. So I do the powers of 2 with this machine, you will see. 2, and I put it as a constant, and then I multiply, you see? 32, 64, and you see how it is operating, eh? And the speed of it. We will deduce the speed from a simulation we also fabricated. We made a full simulation of it, so we understand everything what's going on there. You see? And the Nixies, the beautiful Nixies, are working very well. And this kind of depth in the Nixie, I mean, I just adore this kind of things, yeah, I mean. You see? Voilà, so this is, I think, 2 to the power 34 or something like this. So it is working. So very please send it to Mr. Hilbert. Look, I mean, I think you will enjoy it as much as I do. This is now what's going on here, eh, in Belgium. And so, in fact, what we uncovered is, in fact, as I said, there was this puzzling thing in the whole reverse engineering. There are 2 registers which keep a decimal point. One for the decimal point on the screen, but the other one, what is it doing? And so after some discussion and some thinking, it came out that we could put for the constant of multiplication another number of decimals behind the comma than the display shows. It can be full precision or a little precision. Nowhere documented, but as this ring register was anyhow, this chip was a double one, I think the Japanese have thought, look, let's use it, we can use it for the constant, but it was nowhere documented. We uncovered it by looking at the logic of the design. And so you see here what it means. So in fact, an example, I put 4 decimals after the comma, so I put in my constant 3, pi, and I multiply and I see this number, fine. And so this is the constant here, 4 decimal precision. If I now switch without doing anything else, without a clear, to 2, and I do the calculation, I see that in fact the full precision has been used, but cut to 2, fine. So now I clear, and I do everything with 2, so the constant is only 2, that means 3.14, and then I see 5 plus 3.14 is 15.70, it means that in this case, hidden in the memory is sitting this four precision numbers. So the constant of multiplication can be different than the numbers of decimal I show on the screen. Nobody knew it was possible, and we discovered it, I mean, after being puzzled about why two registers. I mean, it cost them more, and why did they do it? But everything is now clear, of course. And so, this then, in parallel, in fact, in May we had already the simulation. So, based on the gates, and you see here part of these gates here, so you see here an what is called in the code of Mr. Hilbert, an negative and n, because there are negative things and here and there, this and it consists of, it is this one, this MO23, there are three inputs, 1, 2, 3, here, and then it's called MO23, and this goes then into this OR, and you see it goes into the OR, and it also comes, there's another input coming from this gate with diode 128, it goes in there. And then the next step, this in fact annihilates each other, so we left it out, because this double negation is gone. So we have this other one, which is this, again, an N and N. This is called then gate diode 160, where goes in this output here and this bit phase 4. This goes then into a ring register, and this is then also declared in this code, a ring register with this as input. And so from the logic design, simply typing all the things which were there, and then having this code working on this, we got the full simulation. But, I mean, there were some corrections to be done, because the problem is the difference between real life and simulation. There can be some propagation delays, which your simulation does not take into account correctly, or perhaps too much. So you have to check here and there that the pulses are coming with the right relative timing. But after that it worked, and here is then the simulation. You see, the simulation gives you here the operation flags, multiplication, additions, etc., etc. The sequence of the states, state 11, state 21, state 12, then to state 13, etc., etc. And here the registers are one called here, which is Rx, Ry, and Rm. And so you put in the numbers here, 4, and then one part of the multiplication, 4, and 5, 6, 7, the other part. And then the multiplication goes on, and you will see how much time it takes guessing from this diagram, you see. So this is then the multiplication. So I put the button equal, then there is a flag set operational key pressed, and then you see that the whole, and this is also very interesting to see, because they did not have a lot of memory, the Japanese in this time, they wanted to save on everything, and so they multiply and put the result of the multiplication in the least significant digits of the memory. So it goes on and shifts on, and it all comes right. So you see here, they first shift the 4 to the farthest position, and then copy the 5, 6, 7 in that and start to add 3 times, 4 times, etc. Shift it up again, add again, etc. And the whole result is finally to be found in the least significant digits of the memory and copied back to register Y, because this was the register which is displayed in the machine. And so you can immediately guess how long a multiplication takes, and we will do that with another example here. You see the multiplication here, another one I took, which was it's the same one. And in fact, you see it took about 30 shifts here, 30 different steps, and each step was about 3.5 milliseconds. And the clock was 20 kilohertz. From that was derived the bit phases, and from that was derived the digit phases. And in fact, the digit phase, the 17 digit phase, is one cycle, which is done 17 times the 4 bits, times, I mean, the period of the 20 kilohertz, it comes to 3.5 milliseconds. And so in this case, you have, 30 or something shifts times 3.5, and you get then, in fact, something like about 0.2 seconds for a multiplication. But it can be longer. If you have more digits, there are more shifts needed, and so the maximum is about half a second for large numbers. So still fast, but I mean, in these days, very slow, of course. But very nice to study this thing and to understand how things were done so many years ago, and I think largely forgotten at the moment. There's no documentation to be found. And so this, for this reason alone, I enjoyed it a lot. And so it was a very nice experience. And so I'm now doing something else, because the simulation by Mr. Hilbert is a first step. It's a kind of a simulation where you see all the things passing, but I would like to have a simulation where you see really the display continuously being updated by the ring registers, etc. That's now being done. and as far as I find the time. And I do this with this very nice tool, which is free on the internet, Digital. You find it as a GitHub project by, I think it's a professor, Neumann, in Germany. And all the things are already implemented. I'm checking now the whole timing. I found a lot of propagation delays which were too long. And I'm now discussing with him if he could help me to perhaps have an exception here and there to have a zero propagation delay, because the problem is the gates are the diodes and the resistor combination, which are very fast. They're very fast. But he takes into account a gate with a unit delay. And so as I have for these digit phases and these bit phases, several gates, there's an enormous delay in the code which is not really present in reality. So I have prepared that by having two clocks, one clock for the generation of the bit phases, etc., and one other clock, which is of course synchronous, but delayed or earlier, to get into the code. So that part is solved, but still there are still a kind of delays which I have to find out, which I will do, and hopefully then we'll come to a real simulation which is running all the time, as it is in the calculator, you see. And so this is, I mean, a question to all of you, do you have, I mean, other logic software packages which could, I mean, have a bit more flexibility in the propagation delay, perhaps, I don't know. Any suggestion would be nice. Otherwise, I will just continue and debug it and find it. Or perhaps Mr. Neumann will come up with a solution, I don't know, but I mean, there's no stress to this. It's just a hobby, it's a kind of a pleasant experiment. And I mean, honestly, I would wish that everybody has this once in his life, this such a discovery. I mean, from totally zero, totally black, even despairing because there is, I see, broken, burned out, you can't find it, etc. And nevertheless, it's repaired. But in the meantime, I must tell you, I found a very small Swedish shop in Malmö. And I don't know how I came on it, but he had a lot of these neck ICs. Unbelievable. And so, in fact, I could replace some of the ICs which I had by these ICs, and they were still working. Was really incredible, yeah. And so, to summarize a little bit, we had a successful repair of a 1971 Japanese calculator, let us say, from the old era, and before the HP machines. And it was very instructive. I learned a lot, although I knew logic, but I mean, not very deep, because my field is totally different. But very, very pleasant to work with Mr. Hilpert over the internet, 10,000 kilometers. I've never seen him, we only spoke by, even not by telephone, only by internet. No documentation, not at all. Several ICs, totally unknown, black hole, derived by logic, then the reverse engineering, reconstructed one as it should be from the logic, and it worked. I mean, six major faults found and repaired, all done. The simulation written by Mr. Hilpert, extremely understanding to follow the logic of the machine. And in fact, I checked once by oscilloscope if it was the same. It's exactly the same. I mean, it took me full day to see all the bits and moving them around, etc. But indeed, it was the same. And then, if you want more info, and I really can recommend this website here, which is the website of Mr. Hilpert. As I said, he's an electronic digital genius. I mean, he knows a lot of stuff. He's very didactic. You will enjoy looking at this website. And in fact, there was one of the colleagues who has a digital PDP. He has also some pages on the PDP. He has pages on the rope memory. He has pages on the ring memory, etc. Lots of very interesting topics, very didactically explained. I mean, I can recommend all of you have a look there, because there are certainly topics which can be of use in further work which you would do later on any digital device, you see. So that is what I wanted to present you. I thank you very much for your attention, and I hope that you enjoyed it as much as I did, and perhaps I could bring some of the enthusiasm. So, I just can show you the machine here in real time. Ah, there's no power, can that be? No power? No power, probably no power. Is there power? Then the machine is not working. Must be no power. It's probably not sitting well. Mm-hmm. Working? I try. No? Ah yeah, there it is. And so now I will just do this 2, so I put the constant, and I put 2, and we do the powers of 2, you see, 2, eh? Okay. And then times, and you see S.
4.
Yeah, and now it's repeated, you see, but you see how it goes, I mean, it's very nice, yeah?
Mooi, zeg.
The one is missing.
Yeah, but now the Nix is have to warm up a little bit, you see. It depends on temperature. Yeah, yeah. And so there, but they come, they come, you see, the zero will come.
Zero will come.
It will come. There it is. Yeah, you see? You see? So that's overflow. That means overflow. Oh. But now there's another point I wanted to tell you, but at the second machine of the same class, and that was working except for the division. The division, depending on temperature, was one digit or two. I mean, but so I said, look, I mean, could we have a look at that? Yes, we made a second reverse engineering machine. So I made also the drawings again, send it. 1 month later, the whole schematic. And then said, look, where should we look? Ah, that must be probably one of the loop counters, which is not working well. So we went there. And after, let's say, half an hour, I found out that this diode here, this one, was the culprit. It conducts in the reverse direction after a certain voltage. So that thing out, whole thing repaired. The second one. Voilà. Alsjeblieft. 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 Voilà. But the website of Brent is excellent. You'll find a lot of stuff there. Really. Yeah? You see, that was my
experience. Ik heb die ook, ja. Ja, ja. Ah, maar dat was de vierde mixes. Ja, ja. Maar ik heb de mechanische. Dat kan zijn, dat weet ik. Ik heb nooit een hand. Ja, een groot spul. Ja. Was dat met Osso? Was dat met Osso? Ja, met Osso. Dat zit los. Ik heb dat voor. Ja, heeft hij ook nog? Nee, zij is weg.